Please be seated. On behalf of the Principal and Chair of Governors, welcome to this year's Remembrance Service at Framlingham College Chapel. Such strange times. But they do provide us with new opportunities. And I'm delighted to welcome this morning governors, parents, OFs, and other VIPs from around the world as we mark this act of remembrance. I'm aware that we have views down under in Hong Kong, Europe, and every corner of the UK. Wherever you are with us in spirit this morning in this magnificent chapel. Our preacher is the Lord Dannett, and we're honored to have him as our guest this morning. We also welcome Olivia Pitcher, OF. It's lovely to have you, and she will lead us in song too. Might I at this moment just also thank our choir, who will give us the opportunity to mark this occasion with lovely music. Thank you very much to the choir and the music department, and then to Tom and Steph for their technical wizardry. We really appreciate it. We lost over 250 OFs in the two world wars, and in more recent times, OFs have given the ultimate sacrifice. Today, we remember them all. We hold them in our thoughts and prayers. We also know of family members, of partners who have lost loved ones. And Mrs. North will lay a wreath later on in memory of all those loved ones who stayed behind and supported. We remember their sacrifice too. Amen. To worship Almighty God, whose purposes are good, whose power sustains the world he has made, who loves us even though we have failed in his service, who gave Jesus Christ as the light of the world. We ask that we may seek understanding when points of view differ, that we may settle conflicts peacefully and uphold the laws of God. Jesus taught us to call God our Father, and so in faith and trust we pray together the word of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
This morning's reading is taken from Micah, chapter 4. Now it shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established at the top of the mountains and shall be exalted above the hills, and peoples shall flow to it. Many nations shall come and say, come, and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He would teach us his ways, and we shall walk in his paths. For out of Zion the law shall go forth, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between many peoples, and rebuke strong nations far away. They shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war any more. But everyone shall sit under his vine and under his fig tree, and no one shall make them afraid, for the mouth of the Lord of hosts has spoken. Amen.
Amen. In Picardy now, the roads are white and the sun shines hot through blue skies. All the roadside and adjoining fields are powdered with a white powder which passing lorries churn up on the roads and which the breezes lift and form into drifting smoke clouds of dust. The countryside is full rich with summer tints. The ripening corn wave their yellow heads and smile and frolic in the cornfields, dancing to the sun. The land is undulating here, dropping and rising there, and reaching far away, showing treetops and woodlands green-bronzed. Hard by, a tiny river flows through the avenues of trees, mingling further down with its own, the waters of a mighty river. There is quiet here the day long, and peacefulness and gentleness the night long, the softening peace and sweet gentleness of moon and stars. Away in Picardy, there where men fight and kill, the countryside was pleasant once. Peaceful fields and valleys, uplands and ridges in bold outline. Where once the husbandman ploughed and tilled his ground, sowed and reaped his harvest, all now is desolate and brought to ruin. The land is sore bruised and hurt with bursting shells and mines, and furrowed trenches deep. And red is all the soil, and foul with the smell of mortality. Away in Picardy, these have found peace. Peace with the stars and the moonlit night in the quietude of death.
Trees are green in Suffolk, where the weeds are in the pool. Wild roses bloom in Suffolk, and the shade of trees is cool. But Aden rocks are burning hot, whereon no man may lie, and Aden sands are salt and red beneath the brazen sky.
I would I were in Suffolk, where the larks sing in the air, for my rifle's barrel's burning beneath the blinding glare, as I fight for home and Suffolk, where the daisies deck the lea, on the scorching stones of Aden, beside the blazing sea.
Cliffs of Dover tomorrow, just you wait. free. The shepherd will tend his sheep, the valley will bloom again, and Jimmy will go to sleep.
May the words of my mouth and the thoughts of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Well, may I begin this morning by thanking the chaplain for his very kind invitation to give the address on this Remembrance Sunday. I had been looking forward to my first visit to Framlingham College, but sadly it was not to be, with coronavirus preventing me from travelling to Suffolk today, and I'm so sorry about that. But let me continue by asking you to use your imagination for a few moments and try to visualise an event that took place some 38 years ago on an island in the South Atlantic. It was still dark in the early morning on what turned out to be one of the last full days of the Falklands War in 1982, when a two-man reconnaissance patrol from 22 SAS, led by Captain John Hamilton, an officer in my regiment and non-secondment to the SAS, heard the sound of movement behind them. The patrol had been lying up for several days, gathering intelligence on Argentinian movements around their headquarters at Port Howard on West Falkland. The two British soldiers froze, hoping that this Argentinian patrol would not stumble across them on the bare hillside. But the patrol kept coming towards them. A brisk firefight soon developed. John Hamilton was hit quite early in the engagement, and realising that their position was hopeless, he ordered the other soldier, his signaller, to make a break for it, while he remained to give cover and fire. The signaller edged himself away from their position, using the little cover that was available, while Captain Hamilton kept the Argentinians pinned down. He was hit again, and his rate of fire slackened, and then hit a third time. He was killed. The signaller made good his escape. Captain Hamilton was decorated posthumously for outstanding gallantry, and is buried close to where he fell, on the hillside overlooking Port Howard. He gave his life that another might live. And at this Remembrance Tide, those who died like Captain John Hamilton are the reason that we gather year after year around our war memorial, to remember with great gratitude not only the many thousands of men and women who gave their lives in the two world wars, but also those who have lost their lives in a host of campaigns since. And they all did so that we might be able to live in peace and freedom today. They gave their today for our tomorrow, the ultimate sacrifice. And what a responsibility I think that that places on us. So it's very right that at this time of year we should stop, remember and give great thanks for the sacrifice of those who have risked their lives, from Passchendaele in Flanders to Port Stanley in the Falklands, from Belfast in Northern Ireland to Basra in Iraq, and from Sarajevo in Bosnia to Sangin in Afghanistan. And moreover, we should be very conscious that such sacrifice is not just a thing of yesterday. It's a here and now matter, as so many continue to be caught up in the slipstream of international terrorism and in today's conflicts around the world. But it is the individual people involved, not the events, that I want us to concentrate our thoughts on this morning. At first glance, major wars are fought by mass armies marching across the battlefields of history. But those marching armies are made up of individual soldiers, each with their own hopes and fears. If you'd gone to the Tower of London at this time of year in 2014, as I suspect some of you may have done, and when you looked into the moat, you would have seen not the green grass that you might have expected, but instead a sea of red, depicting the blood-swept battlefields of the Great War. And on closer inspection, it was not just a sea of red, but an array of individual glazed ceramic poppies, 888,246 of them, each one the size of a heart, one poppy for every British and colonial soldier who had lost their lives in the Great War. Now, wars might be started by governments for a variety of motives, but they're fought by ordinary men and women, each one precious, not only to their families and to their countries, but precious to our Creator, God Himself. Each of those 888,246 poppies represented a life lost and a family shattered in that terrible war just over a century ago. I think it was that realisation of individual personal tragedy and sacrifice that made that commemorative installation so effective. Now, it's sometimes asked of the major wars in the past, was God on our side? But of course, that is fundamentally the wrong question. God did not create nations or states that they might fight against each other and invoke God to be on their side. He just made individual people. He made all those individual soldiers represented by those poppies. But the question for us, as it was for them, is not whether God is on our side, but whether we are on God's side personally. Because the relationship that really matters in life and before our own death is our own relationship with God. He made us, he loves us, and he wants us to have a personal relationship with him. It's often said there are no atheists in a foxhole, and those great war soldiers represented by the poppies at the Tower would have had to confront the issues of life and death every day they served in the trenches, as they clutched their rifles and machine guns in the clawing mud amidst the cacophony of deafening sounds. We can only surmise something of the anguish that went on in their hearts 100 years ago, but we do know what is going on in our hearts today. In my early years in the army, I endeavoured to live as a Christian, but there were competing pressures, and it became too easy to duck the difficult issues and go too much with the flow. And that was until I was personally confronted with issues of life and death. But even having my driver shot dead beside me in Belfast, or being just a few yards away when my company commander and three other soldiers were killed by an IED in South Armagh, even those events didn't fully focus my mind. It was not until, as a 26-year-old captain, when I had a major stroke, did I really consider the quality of my commitment to Christ. As the German doctor in the main hospital in Berlin said to Pippa, my wife of just 6 months, "It is how you say in England, 50-50, we win some, we lose some." Now, the day, as it happened, that I was taken ill was the 11th of November, 1977. And we all know that the 11th of November each year is the anniversary of Armistice Day, when at the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month in 1918, the surrender of Germany to end the First World War was announced. But a surrender is two things. It's the end of the fighting, and it's the beginning of the peace. I found that after years of fighting with my Creator, compromising and ignoring his challenges, I found that a far better way of life was to commit myself wholeheartedly to him, to surrender my will to his will, and thereby gain the peace and purpose in life that only complete trust in Jesus Christ can give. And we can be assured in the turbulent times of 2020, like the turbulent times in the past, that Almighty God, through the ultimate sacrifice of his Son, Jesus Christ, still wants us to reach out to him, to kneel at the foot of his cross today, to look towards him, and by taking God's hand, to place our trust and our future in him. It's only then we can end our individual conflict of how to live our lives and be welcome to walk side by side with him in his service and walk in sure and certain hope. In an individual life lived with God, in peace or war, in joy or tragedy, we, as St. Paul wrote in Romans chapter 8, are more than conquerors through him who loves us. Moreover, lives lived in tune with God, committed to Christ and open to the Holy Spirit, those lives can change families, can change communities, and can change nations. This is not something done by mighty armies. It's done by ordinary individuals. That is the challenge, the opportunity, and the choice that is before us today. So on this Sunday of Remembrance, let us look beyond the mass armies and the clash of nations or ideologies who wonder whether God was on their side. But let us just see the ordinary men and women themselves and give thanks for their service and their sacrifice in their day. And for us, surely the challenge is to face those things that confront us now and to ask ourselves what is really important in our lives, whether we're willing to let God into our lives, to let him change our lives, our hearts and our actions, and to do it not just for ourselves, but thereby to influence our families, our communities and our nation. If that were to be the case, and we were to make that personal commitment today, that would make this Sunday, this Remembrance Sunday, a very special Sunday to remember. Amen.
Let us remember before God and commend to his sure keeping those who have died in war, particularly those members of this college, the prep school, and all those known in the congregation, both here and wherever you are. They shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember them. We will remember.
Thank you. Let us pray. We turn to God in sorrow as we acknowledge before him the suffering of his world and the pain of his people. When hatred causes divisions between nations and alienates races and cultures. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. When indifference diminishes the dignity of the imprisoned, the homeless, and the refugee. When pride leads us to trust ourselves and to disregard the demands of your word and your laws. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. We pray for all who suffer as a result of war, for the injured and disabled, for the mentally distressed, for the homeless and refugees, for those who are hungry, and for all who have lost their livelihood and security. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, hear our prayer. For those who mourn their dead, for those who have lost husband, wife, children, or parents, for those who have lost any of their relatives or friends. We remember them today and commend their spirits to you, the giver of life and eternity. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, hear our prayer. Amen.
Let us pledge ourselves anew to the service of God and of our fellow human beings, that we may help, encourage, and comfort others, and support the organizations which are working for the relief of those in need, and for the peace and welfare of the nations of the world. We say together, Lord God our Father, we pledge ourselves to serve you and all mankind, in the cause of peace, for the relief of want and suffering, and for the praise of your name, guide us by your Spirit. Give us wisdom, give us courage, give us hope, and keep us faithful now and always. Lead us from death to life, from falsehood to truth. Lead us from despair to hope, from fear to trust. Lead us from hate to love, from war to peace. Let peace fill our hearts, our world, our universe. Amen.
Peace of God enfold our nation. May the love of God embrace all humanity.